It's an art form with both formality and flexibility. And so its elements are beautifully adaptable to the soft luster and malleability of gold. Bill Reed bases a bracelet design on one of the figures from Haida mythology.
The bracelet I'm working on now is going to have a dogfish woman design on it. And this is a little drawing I did to get an idea of how to arrange it on the gold band. This is the center part, which will be done in repoussé, giving a three-dimensional effect. And it's half dogfish and half woman. I guess I should explain that the dogfish is a small shark, which is found in profusion in the waters off the northwest coast. This is a vague representation of a dogfish. It looks, as you can see, like an ordinary shark. It's about 4 feet long. And it's quite different from this, which is what the dogfish can look like in the Haida iconography. To get from this to this, the dogfish lady, you keep her forehead, still has the nostrils and the wrinkles, but she has a nose, and in my case, I made her nose extend up into her forehead.
Bill is also using an earlier piece as a design model. He marks the bracelet blank with lines to guide the pressures he'll apply to give depth to the figure he's designed.
So, transferring her to the bracelet design, you see her head in full face, and on either side of her, on the bracelet, is the body of the dogfish, long and slender, curling back here. And the tail is tucked into this part of the field. There's the anal fin, two dorsal fins, with a little spike in front of each one, which is characteristic of the dogfish. Dorsal fins are somewhat abstracted, but still reminiscent of the actual shape of in the real animal. And the pectoral fin is tucked away down here to fill up this area of the drawing. This will be, of course, transferred exactly to this side, and the whole design will be made somewhat three-dimensional by repoussé, and then it will be engraved and become a bracelet.
Symmetry is a tradition in Haida art, although the artist may occasionally choose to inject some differences in the two halves of his design. Bill Reed achieves symmetry by engraving one half of the figure and then using Scotch tape as tracing paper to transfer the mirror image of that half to the other side of the bracelet. He works with the precision and superb craftsmanship that typify the Edenshaw line. Once the design's been inscribed, Bill heats the gold to melt the pitch that's been holding it to its wooden backing. A dip in an acid bath and then in a neutralizing solution will clean the metal. With this artist, there's much more to his work than mere technique. There's a depth of feeling and knowledge about the roots of Haida art. For example, how was the dogfish design developed from the animal itself?
You have to look at the dogfish in a special way. And I saw it from this aspect first in the Vancouver Aquarium, when one was swimming toward me and I was looking through the glass. And from his underside, he looks something like this. is long and narrow, and he has some wrinkles under his nose for some reason or another. And you can see part of his gill slits and the pectoral fins and, of course, the rest of him, his body. And I began to get a clue as to how this abstraction was arrived at. If you turn him over on his belly so you can see his back and split him right down the middle, that's right through the body, so he's only attached by the skin on his front side, and open him up, you would get something that looks vaguely like this.
And from that image came the mythic dogfish. The creature perpetuated by Charles Edenshaw in his unique style when he did this drawing. How he shaped the form lines, the ovoids, and the U-shapes is as distinctive as a signature. Now the bracelet is carefully given shape. Most of the time, Bill Reed works in 22-karat gold, a gold and copper alloy whose color and softness he finds just right. Once he's got the gold piece bent and curved the way he wants it, he can start giving the design its three-dimensional quality. This he does with a technique called repoussé. First, the piece of gold is firmly attached to a bed of pitch. This holds it in place and gives it a backing firm enough for support, but soft enough to allow the gold's inner surface to be indented with pressure. Hammering from this side causes parts of the figure to be raised on the bracelet's outer surface. And later, hammering from the other side will push part of that raised design back down again. Push and repush. Repoussé. And when all the work is done, it's magnificent. In the late 60s, Bill Reed received a Canada Council grant to study metalwork in Europe. While he was overseas, the Central School of Design in London offered him the use of their facilities. In 1967, he created this striking contemporary necklace in gold and diamonds. Here, platinum and white gold in another necklace, this time fashioned from tiny, meticulously made metal cylinders. Bill Reed hadn't abandoned his Haida roots. but he was extending his range in both design and technique. On his return to Canada, he'd do some of the best work of his career. One of the major early sources of Bill's designs was the work of his great-great-uncle, Charles Edenshaw. A Raven drawing became a Raven bracelet. In silver, in 20th century terms, and with 20th century techniques. Bill's researches had included hours spent with whatever illustrated books showed Northwest Coast art, and more hours spent talking with the older people who remembered the mythic meanings of the designs. As well, a Seattle art historian named Bill Holm described and named the design elements, working out the vocabulary and grammar of this stunning visual language. This silver bracelet is a copy of one made by Charles Edenshaw. In Bill Reed's early days as a jewelry maker, he often duplicated his ancestors' work and noted the source of the design on the bracelet's inner surface.
In 1948, at the age of 28, while a CBC broadcaster in Toronto, Reed enrolled in a two-year jewelry-making program at the Ryerson Institute of Technology, hoping one day to create bracelets such as those made by his grandfather, Charles Gladstone, or other Haida relatives. This was followed by a one-and-a-half-year apprenticeship in a platinum and diamond workshop. All the while, Reed made regular visits to the Royal Ontario Museum to see the Tanu Pole, which had come from his grandmother's village and which seemed to call him back to the West Coast, to Haida Gwaii, and to his heritage. Known examples of Reed's earliest and modernist works are few. He produced a certain number of pieces based mostly on natural forms found in the human figure, flowers, and marine motifs. When Reed began his career as a goldsmith, Haida's style had lost much of its power of expression due to the demoralizing effects of a century of colonization, disease, and culturally repressive Canadian laws. Haida's style had lost most of its vitality and convincing power. Reed searched early ethnographic publications and museum collections for exceptionally strong works executed by anonymous 19th century masters. He immersed himself into traditional Haida art, trying to understand the logic behind the form, a goal he reached at the end of his second creative phase. After a trip in 1954 to Haida Gwaii, Reed saw a pair of deeply carved bracelets engraved by his great-uncle, Charles Edenshaw, and said the world was not the same. These ornaments left an indelible impression on him. Deeply carved is an aesthetic judgment. In Haida language, which has no general word for art, deeply carved just means well-made, a quality Reed always strove to achieve. Reed had no mentor to teach him the Haida convention, so copying old designs from book illustrations and museum pieces was his only way of learning. His copies, however, through the use of new technology and new medium, were three-dimensional adaptations of old two-dimensional designs. The works that Reed created at the end of his Haida phase show fluency in his newly acquired visual language and poetry. They show his complete control of the medium and illustrate the complementary relation between his goldsmithing techniques and the overall design of the work. Technique itself becomes a form of artistic expression, bringing the magic of the metal to its full advantage. Not unlike early traditional wooden animal form bowls, the creature and the object it embellishes become one and the same, creating a unity between function and aesthetics. Reed had achieved a new plateau, which he could have called form and freedom. He had become so fluent, even eloquent, in his new visual language that he could freely move in and out of the convention. Confident and empowered with that freedom, he finally abandoned Haida art, which had been part of the signature with which he had engraved his works for nearly 20 years. Reed's third phase is marked by his return from London in 1969, where he was studying museum collections while learning at the Central School of Design to master another ancient technique, the lost wax. He settled in Montreal for 3 years, where he completed the Milky Way, a gold and diamond necklace. There, he created critical works, among them the iconic boxwood, Raven and the First Men. He also began his multiple edition pieces. There, he was also diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. He returned to Vancouver in 1973, where he lived until his death in 1998. Reed's quest for understanding the essence and the roots of a unique art form led him to discover his own Haida-ness and, in the process, restored much of the dynamic power, magic, and possibility to the art. In doing so, he became the catalyst to empower a whole nation.